Penguin Random House Canada presents All Together Now, A Newfoundlander's Late Tales for Heavy Times, by me, Alan Doyle. Read for you by the author, me, Alan Doyle. This book is dedicated to everyone working to find a way out of this pandemic, and everyone holding fast on the front lines to keep us safe while we're still in it. Introduction. I'm supposed to be in Italy. To be specific, today I'm supposed to be in Matera, a wondrous ancient cave city carved into the hills of southern Italy. My bandmates and I were to play a concert here, at the foot of a vineyard on a sandstone bluff dotted with olive trees. I bet the after-show party would have featured rare wines that I could never find or afford even if I could. I'm sure we'd all be beaming as we wandered the winding stone roads at midnight or later, as bands on tour often do, headed for the one garden bar still open, cold Peroni flowing hand over fist for the Friday faces not yet ready to part with the warm glow of night. I am not in Italy. I am not where I'm supposed to be, or doing what I'm supposed to be doing. Just about the entire performing world, from bands to dancers to DJs to circus clowns, would all say the same thing. Like so many in the gig and gathering industry, I am home, in my basement, occupying myself as best I can while waiting for the COVID-19 pandemic to pass and the green light to signal that our tour buses can roll once again. As I type this, it's a Friday in July of 2020. It is my 17th Friday in a row without some kind of gig. I suspect this is my lengthiest consecutive streak at home since 1994 and offstage since 1982. Now, I wouldn't want you to think it's all bad. I am enjoying the long overdue extended family time and sleeping in my own bed. But times like this, supper time on a Friday, when I should be sound checking, and watching people form up and down the street around the venue, and excited people craning their necks to see who's on the bus or cloistering at close-by patios with glasses raised and troubles soon to be forgotten for a few hours, I miss it. I'm built for the road. Bandmates have commented that my Petty Harbour Hobbit DNA is genetically programmed to live out of a 6-foot-long by 30-inch-wide tour bus bunk and sleep soundly while a diesel engine pushes a 45-foot tube on rubber tires through the Canadian winter. Being in one place for this long is not what I'm accustomed to at all. I miss the gigs and the crowds and the physical and mental satisfaction that comes with singing a whole song while others sing along with you. I miss looking across the stage to wink at a bandmate who's just played something incredible, or giggling as one of them, or more likely I, play or sing a note so wrong that it almost derails the whole train. I miss the concerts and all that comes with such a privileged life. But I also miss the gatherings, not just on the road, but at home as well. I live in St. John's, Newfoundland, a city with one of the few great pub cultures in North America. We Newfoundlanders are sociaholics, if you'll forgive a generalization. Gathering is our superpower. We do it at home or abroad. We do it in good times and especially in bad. We find each other and congregate and talk and joke and complain and sing. I think this could be why COVID-19 hurts us so badly. It has taken away the one surefire defense we have used against so many hardships of history. We get together. We work it out. We get through it. We do what has to be done. And then we celebrate with the best of them. COVID-19 has borne us our kryptonite. We can't get together, not to talk or joke, not to complain or sing, not to work it out and get through it, and certainly not to celebrate. For a gathering pub culture like ours, this has been especially hard. If you're like me, you're longing for a pub with a black and golden pint on the bar and another one not too far behind, where friends play a game of sure-ass nutting as we try to constantly one-up the story that's just been offered to the gang, where all the mouths at the table are moving at the same time and no one seems to mind, where one yarn leads to another so quickly you have to be as ready as an Olympian at the start line to get your tail in before someone else is well into theirs already. Alas, right now, all we can do is imagine such a time. So why don't we do just that, dear reader? Why don't we imagine we are in such a pub, all together, now, and the stories are flying? Let's say we are mid-stride on a Friday, jammed into the corner at the Duke of Duckworth, on the last bar stool, my left arm on the bar and my right on the high table, the whole pub before me. The best piece of real estate on earth tonight. The musings to follow are offered just as they would be from that throne of a stool. Told in response to a prompt or question or nudge or dare. Told as they occur to me, sometimes to make a point, and more often for no rhyme or reason other than they might make someone laugh or help turn a good night into a great one. Perhaps a few stories will not only pass the time, but get us a little closer to a time when we can do this for real. I'll be there with bells on. Till then, thanks for joining me here. Cheers. It always seems like an innocent enough idea to assemble the gang right after work. Just pop in for one on the way home, you know, before you gets back to your own house and gets too settled in. You'll be home by 5:30 at the latest. Jerry's still got his suit on, pulling at his tie like a kidnapped fella in a chair trying to undo the ropes behind his back. He's excited about his first trip to New York, as he's headed there on a work trip in a few weeks, and I'm happy to tell him about some of my times there. As I lift my voice over the din of the Duke, Jerry is holding a pint like it is the Holy Grail, and the liquid inside it, the antidote to a global pandemic. Perhaps he is right on both counts. The Blind Man and the Can. Great Big C landed an amazing gig to perform on Canada Day 2000, right in the middle of Central Park in New York City. I've always been fascinated with Manhattan, and Central Park in particular. As a kid, I would seek out maps of Manhattan and wonder at the rows and rows of perfectly straight numbered streets and avenues. There was not a single piece of straight road anywhere in my young life in Petty Harbour, and barely any along the ex-cow paths turned roadways of St. John's. A perfect urban grid seemed absurd, especially one lined with skyscrapers. Tallest building I'd seen before my 20s was the 11-story Confederation Building in St. John's, and there was only one. But in the middle of Manhattan, there were hundreds of them, and many times taller. How did the sun get in? How did you see the edge of town with all the tall buildings around? How did you know where you were without a beach or an ocean, a river or a hill to serve as a guide? Though I had seen parts of the city in hundreds of movies and TV shows, I had trouble imagining what Manhattan actually looked like in person. And there on the map, right in the middle of this impossible Gotham of straight lines of streets and towers reaching into the clouds, was this green rectangle. I remember noticing it on a map in a school book in grade 6 or 7 and thinking it must be a mistake or the handiwork of a mischievous classmate who'd colored over a chunk of Manhattan with a green marker. I looked closer. It was real. I counted the numbered streets that bordered it and quickly realized how enormous the green rectangle must actually be. How could a city so big, so brimming with concrete and brick and pavement, save so much space for one park? I found the very thought of it baffling. I would have to see it for myself, I suppose. On GBS's first visit to NYC a few years earlier, we played in Lower Manhattan at the famous Bottom Line. It was a quick in and out, and I didn't get a chance to go to the park. So here, on July 1st, 2000, not long after my 30th birthday, the same me that drew his finger over the green rectangle in the school book was not only going to see Central Park for real, he was going to play a gig there. I was beyond excited. As well as a wanderlust dream come true, that day in the park was an incredible opportunity for our band's introduction into the United States. Thousands of expat Canadians would throng to the iconic park to celebrate the true North strong and free in the heart of the U.S. If we were to ever tour successfully and make a cent in America, we'd need every single one of these Canucks on our side. And today was a day to impress them. We'd also get a chance to impress and hopefully befriend the two other bands on the bill, as an association with either of them would boost our visibility. We were opening for the Tragically Hip, perhaps the biggest and most internationally successful Canadian rock band on the road at the time. The Hip had sold millions and millions of records, had dozens of music videos in heavy rotation, and had even played on Saturday Night Live. When they arrived, many of the Hip crew guys were unloading what seemed like an insane amount of equipment, filling up the backstage.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.